Coming. My name is Dean Wampler. I know a lot of you, but it's great to meet new people as well. I work for TypeSafe, and it's basically my job to figure out our big data strategy, and it's mostly been focused on Spark. So sort of the elevator pitch, the summary of this talk will be that Spark is driving adoption of Scala right now, and it's transforming the way big data is being done from the horrible MapReduce model that people were using to something a little bit more modern, more functional, and so forth. The flip side is it's not maybe as functional as a lot of us would like. There's plenty of technical debt in Spark, but you know, I think for the most part it's a really good thing for our industry and for us in particular in the Scala community. So that's sort of the elevator pitch. I always use my travel photography in the talks. This is a hiking trip in a national park called Olympic National Park, which is on the northwest corner of the U.S., and it's partly on the ocean. It's the Pacific Ocean beach, and partly up in the mountains, as we'll see. Okay, and actually, you can already get this talk. Polyglotprogramming.com is my vanity website. I've already put the talk up there if you want to grab it. It's rather big because of all the photos. So let's start with a quick introduction to Spark and what it's all about. Why it's interesting, especially for us, but in general, why it's interesting to the big data world. One of the things that's really good about it, before we get into the technical details, is that it gives us a very elegant, mostly functional, concise API for writing data flows, you know, like I need to transform data kind of things, or queries, I need to ask questions of data. And you can do this in five languages as of today: Scala, Java, Python, and R, and SQL, as we'll see. And there are also actually other languages. There's a closure dialect that someone has written, but it's not part of the distribution, for example. We also get the interactive REPL. So you can literally be working with terabytes of data on a cluster, but you're actually just interacting with it using the Scala console, or your REPL, whatever term you want to use. And we'll talk a little bit about notebooks, which is another really cool thing that comes from the data science community, which is like a GUI on top of a REPL where you can do things like graph data, go back, edit previous statements, and rerun them. I think it's actually the way Scala developers should prototype the work they're doing. It's not something we're used to doing because we're used to IDEs and editors, but it can be a very effective tool for getting started and even actually doing real work if it's, you know, like impromptu real-time or interactive analysis of data. And what about performance? Well, this is another area where Spark has really been a big step forward from what we did before, and we'll talk in depth about some of the engineering they're doing to take it even farther. It's basically a lazy API. It looks like the Scala Collections API, and it's inspired by it, but you're actually defining a lazy data flow until you ask for results. And that enables it to be able to do a lot of optimizations under the hood, you know, starting from that API. So you're going to build up a distributed data flow, or rather a directed acyclic graph of processing nodes. And much like a query in SQL, it's going to go through an optimizer and then be distributed over the cluster as needed to do whatever you need to do. And we'll talk a lot about the additional optimizations that are being developed for it. The other thing I'll mention, I'll show you an example of this to make this clear, but it does some smart things like for each little step, it's not going to spawn a separate JVM process the way MapReduce would do, but it actually knows when it can combine things into a single JVM process, eliminate some intermediate data that would have to create otherwise, and that sort of thing. That leads to a lot of improvements. And there's even ways you can tell it when to cache data that you know you're going to use over and over again so that you get even better performance. But that caching has important implications for things like garbage collection, as we'll see. So if we dive down a little bit more into, this is a rainforest actually where this park is, so it's rather moist. The core abstraction is a resilient distributed data set in Spark, and it looks something like this. Your data sort of looks like a collection, at least that's the way you kind of think about it when you're working with it, but it's actually partitioned over a cluster, and there could be, you know, it could be thousands of these partitions depending on how big your data set is and where it's distributed. So typically there's like a distributed file system or database underneath, like the Hadoop distributed file system. It is, as I said, lazily constructed, so on demand it will build up these data structures. But it doesn't necessarily materialize all of them. So each step is going to be an immutable new RDD, at least conceptually, but in reality it only materializes some of those and combines other steps. Now the resilient part of the keyword, the name rather, is that if you lose one of those partitions because a node dies or whatever, because it knows the graph of processing, it can go as far back as it has to reconstruct it. Now that could be expensive, and so there are ways in which you can use caching or checkpointing to prevent it from having to go too far back to recover. So it's nice for that. So let's cut to the chase and look at what an actual example of a Spark program looks like. I'm going to show you a complete one, and it actually fits on a slide, but because of the small screen, I went ahead and blew it up to some larger slides. It's the famous inverted index. It's like the very first thing you'd implement if you were writing a search engine. So suppose I have web crawlers that are crawling the interwebs. They find Wikipedia, and they build up a simple data set, which is not shown. It's an intermediate data set before the final one that's shown. But the intermediate data set is just a list of all the URLs and the contents that were found there. And, you know, they might be more generalized to something like an ID for the URLs or whatever. But anyway, it's just that, you know, two data things. And then some process is going to happen that inverts that index in the sense of tokenizing the words and building up indices, basically, you know, keys as the words, and then a list of all the documents where it was found, or web pages in this case, and also a count of how many times the words were found. Because obviously, if you're building a search engine, people want to see the documents that really talk about the subject, not the documents that mention it in passing. And so, you know, blowing out a little bit more, there's that intermediate data set on the left. Some miracle occurs in the middle that does this inverted index calculation. And here's the miracle. This is an entire Spark program. You could try this at home if you wanted. So let's actually walk through this a little bit. And hopefully even those of you that can see it at this point, hopefully see that it looks a lot like the Scala API for collections. So you always start with a Spark context. That's like your, I'm tempted to say reader monad, but that's not a good analogy. It's like your entry point that knows all about where the cluster is, knows how to do I/O and that sort of thing. And then you're going to instantiate one of these things. And the master argument would be where you say, I'm just running locally, just use my current machine, or I'm actually running in a Hadoop cluster or a Mesos cluster over there, and you give it some program name. And then we start this long sequence of steps. And notice I've written this as a script, so I could be doing this in my REPL. So I'm going to load text data. In this case, I'll assume that each line is one of those records I just put in. More realistically, these days, we would use more sophisticated data formats. There's one called Parquet that's getting popular that gives us binary compression and all kinds of good stuff. But let's assume it's text. We're going to load it from some location in our file system. And the first thing we'll do is map over it and split on the first comma. We'll assume it's comma delimited data. And then return a tuple with that identifier, whatever, or path, whatever that thing was that tells us where the data came from, and then the contents of the data. So that's the first step. And then we're going to flat map over that, and we're actually combining two things here. We're going to tokenize the contents into words, and I have this sort of two words method that kind of hides what we have to do. And actually, maybe it's not a complete program because I'm not showing helper functions like this, but you know, I could have just done split on white space or something. And then we're going to map over each of those words, and notice the tuple I'm returning, a nested tuple of the word and the ID, which again was like the path that we started with, and that's going to be my key for the next step. And then I'm adding a 1 as a value in this outer tuple. I'm basically implementing an idiom for counting things in Spark. And the next step, reduce by key, is an optimized version of group by. So it turns out if you do group by on big data, you're going to build up these massive in-memory groups of data that could conceivably run out of heap. But in this case, I don't want the group. I just basically want to sum up all of these ones. If I was not using ones, I would just count the sizes of the groups. So all I'm going to do then is map over those key value pairs. I'll join those together like through a group by statement, the equivalent thereof, and then apply this function to everything that's left, which is just integers, and I'm just going to sum the integers. So the output will be these nested key value pairs, a unique record for each of those unique key value pairs, and then some count from one to whatever. And that's how we do counting typically in Spark, or one of the ways anyway. I love this line more than any other because it shows the power of Scala. I'm basically just moving parentheses to reposition my data structure to be what I want for the final step, which is to end up with the words by themselves as an index. Literally just pattern matching and tearing apart the tuple and moving the parentheses to be, you know, the word is the key and then the pair, the ID and the count as the value. And then I do an actual group by, I have to do that now because I want to keep everything in those little ID and count pairs. And the output of this thing would be basically individual records with the word as the key and then a sequence, it's actually an iterable and it's something that's Spark specific underneath, of these tuple pairs, IDs, and counts. Map values is like a special case of map, where if I'm not going to change the key, I don't need to like pattern match on the key and then reconstruct a new tuple with it. So it's slightly more efficient than just doing map. So the thing passed to the function here is just that sequence of IDs and counts. And here I'm just going to sort by the count. So you know it would actually be very easy to write this code in line without having to call some special function. You can just use the Scala collection sort by method to do that. And that's exactly what you would do inside this method. And then the last thing is to save it all back to the file system. So once again, all together, you know, it fits on a page easily. And if I just did like inline the helper functions that I kind of glossed over, it wouldn't be that much bigger. So the beauty part is we've taken what was a software development problem in like the MapReduce era and compressed it down to a script that I can write in 30 minutes, which is how long it took me to write this the first time I ever did it, and just get my work done and then iterate from there. So anyway, that's MapReduce, that's Spark doing inverted index. Let's fill in some gaps that I kind of alluded to earlier. So conceptually, I have these processing nodes in my graph here. And what Spark can do is it can say, you know what, when I'm processing these partitions in parallel, you know, I'm going to read in like blocks of the file system, that's the text file bit. I'm going to map over those separately, but I don't need any information exchange between them, and the same for flat map. So I can actually pipeline those steps into one JVM process, not create intermediate RDDs, just a final RDD at the last step. So we get some optimizations done under the hood. It's like a query optimizer in that sense. But as soon as we need to move key value pairs across the cluster to bring them together, that's when Spark triggers a new stage, as they call it, which is like reduce by key. Again, that was like the group by, like a join, something like that. And then I have to do it again when I get to the last group by. So they're basically three stages. If you were watching the Spark web console, you would see that three stages got executed. But you get the some efficiencies there of compressing some of the steps into single JVM processes. There's another feature that Spark offers, which is a streaming model, and it's really a hack. Spark started as a batch mode system, but it turns out streaming, you know, just basically event handling is getting more and more important in big data environments. So what they said is, you know what, our batch mode system is actually pretty efficient. What if we just captured time slices of data and then just ran little mini batch jobs over each of those, one at a time? And maybe we can add some window functions on top of those. So for example, each of these little white boxes would be an RDD, like you know, the thing that we just talked about, and the time window might be down to a second or maybe a minute, whatever. So it's not like a low latency single event system, but when you just want to compress the time between data arrival and information extraction, it's a really nice sort of, you know, 80-20 solution for general streaming problems. So I can do all the same things I just did over RDDs. I could do inverted index incrementally like this if I wanted. And I can even do window functions as sort of an extra feature. So if I was doing like moving averages or something over the whole day, but just in 10-second slices, it would be easy to do that. Anyway, everything we love about the Scala Collections API, and we'll come back to what we hate about it in a little bit, but everything we love about it, which is the easy way of just sequencing things together to get work done, is basically exploited by Spark, which was adapted from the Scala API, and it lets us really compose stuff very quickly and get work done. And I'm using the word compose, not in the sort of category theory word, so, but anyways. But it's also a good foundation, though, for building higher level APIs as well as the performance we get. So one of those higher level capabilities is nested SQL queries, or a more general programmatic model that they recently introduced called data frames that lets us do similar SQL-like things, but more in a type-safe programmatic way. And a simple example of this, so imagine this is actually taken from some training I've written for TypeSafe on Spark. Available at a very reasonable price, I should add. So we add a SQL context. We create our Spark context and wrap it in a SQL context, and that gives us this extra query capability. And the example is you can actually download a data set for all of the flights that occurred in North America over the last 15 or 20 years and do interesting analysis on it. And this particular query I'm going to write is I'm going to pull in data about planes, and knowing the tail number that was flown in a particular flight, I could find out, all right, what plane model was it, when did it go in service, and all that. You can also get the airport data and crazy stuff like this. So anyway, I create my Spark context, wrap it with a SQL context. I'm going to pretend that it's in this file format that's popular in Hadoop called Parquet. Parquet does column storage, column compression. It also shards over, you know, a big cluster for big files. It embeds the schema. So as soon as I load these files, I'll know everything about the data. I'll have the schema already with me. I don't have to do any parsing or anything like that. So it's really nice for that. So the flight data, the plane data, and then I'm going to register them as temporary tables, which is really just a, you know, virtual in-memory thing so that I can write queries against it. And the last thing I'm going to do is cache this data in memory so that I can keep visiting it over and over again. It turns out if you don't cache something, it just goes back and recomputes the DAG every time, which would be kind of stupid if I'm just writing SQL queries. So I'm going to do the same query twice, once with nested SQL. And Runar talked yesterday about the virtues of stringly typed programming, as in there are none. But when you're doing interactive work, this is perfectly fine, because if you screw up the query, you'll know right away that it's wrong. But I wouldn't necessarily use the nested SQL stuff like this in production code unless I tested it really well. You know, the usual arguments back and forth. And so I'm just going to select from the flights and join them with the planes on the tail number, and I'll just print the first 100 I find so that I don't, you know, sit there and wait forever. Or I could use this programmatic API called the DataFrame API, which is type safe. And here it's, you know, it takes a while to learn this API, especially if you know SQL. I can bang that out really quickly, but, you know, just a few details on this. When I say flights and then basically call the apply method with tail num, I'm basically passing an argument that will resolve which column I'm referring to or which field. And then triple equals is a special equals. Basically, I'm building up an expression where I say flights, tail num, equals, 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 planes, tail num. That's building up an expression that has to be evaluated over and over again. It turns out there's some performance implications here that the Spark project wants to fix that we'll come back to in a few minutes. But I can do, you know, type-safe programming if I really want to. So, not too big. It's really great when I'm exploring data interactively to kind of mix SQL and that RDD API that we just looked like, you know, sort of the best of both worlds. Well, I'm not going to go into any detail about this, but the same kind of infrastructure that Spark gives us also lets us write really good machine learning algorithms. And one of the big requirements here is I need to do fast iterations. Whenever you're training a model like a recommender engine or something like that, you need to be able to train incrementally to converge to a solution, for example. And we also use a lot of linear algebra and machine learning, so those need to be fast. And Spark, you know, is good enough to make this viable, much more so than MapReduce could, its predecessor. Similarly, we've always had this notion that we can represent a lot of data as graphs, you know, networks, like think of your Twitter followers and your Facebook friends, whatever. But we tend not to use anything that treats graphs as first-class citizens because of performance issues. Well, now we can do things like incremental traversals to implement, you know, neighbor kind of algorithms or whatever. And we can represent edges and nodes fairly efficiently, better than we could before. So that's all I'm going to say about those two APIs, but just to make the point that you can build all this on top of each other. I think this is my favorite slide. This is actually a rope that you would use to tie a ship to a pier. It's, you know, it's about this thick. There was a lot of junk that had washed up on the beach here, and a lot of it was from Japanese fishing boats after the earthquake a few years ago. Anyway, so let's step back then. What lessons have we learned about the JVM itself as a foundation for big data? Well, it got started for the usual reasons that we had this rich ecosystem of stuff to build on back in the day when they were starting to build Hadoop and other tools. So we've got a bunch of language choices. I threw a bone to Clojure there. We've got tools like IDEs. We just had a great talk by Julian about the new async debugger in Eclipse, for example. Although I'm not sure how you'd use that with Spark. We'll have to figure that one out. Anyway, we can talk about that later. And then there's a whole bunch of libraries, and I just listed a few of the many that we all know that are useful in big data. Breeze is like a wrapper for linear algebra libraries in Fortran. Algebra is a famous library that Twitter wrote for doing like approximate calculations of various stuff. And we've heard about cats already this week, et cetera, et cetera. So another important thing is we have 20 years now of experience actually running JVMs at scale. And we also have lots of Java developers to populate our big cube farms of developers when we need them. So for this reason, a lot of tools have been built on this foundation. And here's just a partial list of some of the big data tools. Obviously, we're talking about Spark. So Spark, Scalding, Summingbird is this guy. Scalding and Summingbird are like precursors to Spark written by Twitter. Also Kafka and Samza, these are actually written primarily in Scala. So Scala's kind of emerged as the de facto development language for big data, as opposed to what data scientists would use, which still like their Python and their R languages and stuff like that. And of course, many of you have used some of these other tools like Solr and Storm and Cassandra. However, the JVM is definitely not a perfect environment. I mean, we can always find something to criticize, and that's certainly true of the JVM. So garbage collection has been a perennial challenge. If you're doing high frequency trading, you're paranoid about garbage collection pauses. That's still an issue. Yes, I am. Thank you very much. That's still an issue with Spark. Although, most of the time, if you're running batch mode jobs and even some streaming jobs, you have more tolerance. You know, if you're doing like 10 second windows or batches, I should say, a quarter second GC pause isn't going to kill you, you hope. But these jobs typically run with giant heaps, so it's not unusual to have hundreds of gigabyte heaps. And so they're typically much bigger than the kind of generic services, especially microservices that we're used to building. So it really puts a lot of pressure on our garbage collection algorithms. The other thing too, I mentioned caching RDDs to get optimal query performance. Well, the drawback of that is that most of those are gonna end up in the old generation of your garbage your heap. And if you have to do like a full GC, which you're gonna just really spend a lot of time cleaning out all that stuff. If you're using one of the older garbage collection algorithms. The other issue that we'll come back to a little bit is that all of these RDDs, at least as of today, are basically like references to other things. And so there's a lot of spread of your data throughout the heap, which means you're gonna have a lot of cache misses when you'd really like to stream data through the CPU as fast as possible. Well, one of the things that we can do to make garbage collection work better is to use the garbage first garbage collector, which came out recently. Well, Java 1.6 isn't that recent, I guess, but nevertheless. But it's not the default, if I'm not mistaken. And it has a good balance of latency versus throughput compared to the others, which tend to favor one or the other. And it basically, instead of having like this big giant chunks of memory, it uses smaller chunks that are kind of distributed over the memory space where it has like the Eden space and old generation and whatnot. So it's a little more efficient. I'm going to summarize a very long blog post, but a really good one if you're doing big data, which is this one that discusses tuning garbage collection to be optimal for Spark. And sort of the conclusion was, these are the flags you should use if you're running Spark at scale and you want a good balance of performance. And I'll let you read this blog post to see why these actually work. There's one other thing we have to think about, which is the way Spark uses memory. It basically divides the heap you give it into two big fractions. The biggest one is what is used to do all this caching. And I think by default it's 60 or 70%, if I remember correctly. So everything else then is what's left over for doing just the regular processing and allocation. You can actually configure this with this property if you want. And in fact, this is something people will do when they're fine-tuning the job based on its observed characteristics. If they're not doing much caching, they can give more memory to regular usage, for example. It turns out object overhead is a big issue in big data. If you think about the Java object model, it's really nice for just general purpose use for supporting general garbage collection, semantics, and so forth, but it has a lot of overhead for what could be, you know, really tightly packed data sets. So for example, in this example, I didn't put the link on the slide, but in the speaker notes, I have a link to a really good presentation that talks about this from the last Spark Summit. But you know, the string ABCD could be as little as 4 bytes if stored in UTF-8. But in fact, it's 48 bytes because there's a whole bunch of overhead, including the fact that it's UTF-16, that just makes it very large. Similarly, arrays, even though arrays are great for packing data, they're only really great if it happens to be primitives like ints or bytes. But as soon as you pack reference objects, you've got all of these, you know, things pointed around the heap, which is, again, potential cache misses. And that's generally true for any reference type we create, whether they're case classes or tuples or Spark's own built-in notion of what a row is in your data set. References around memory, and hence lots of potential for cache misses. So a trivial example, here's a person type. I can inline the value for the age because that's just a primitive, you know, int, but then I have references to other instances of things for like the name and the address. And another one they found to be a performance issue is the regular hash map. So when you go to a hash bucket, it's basically implemented as a linked list. Where each of the key and value may themselves be references to other things in memory. And it turns out this can actually also be a performance bottleneck. So we're going to see how Spark is trying to address these in just a few minutes. But just to complete some things that are missing, like this came up yesterday in a talk. There are no unsigned types in Java, so it's easy to write factorial minus one, whatever that means. A practical issue is that the Python and R is a popular statistician's language. There's a lot of rich data-centric libraries in these environments that we don't quite yet have, although we're working on it in Scala. So you'd like to be able to close that gap. Now, I mentioned we have a lot of Java developers to draw on, but they come with baggage a lot of times, which is thinking about everything in like big enterprise-y ways and building objects when, in fact, functional programming, in my opinion, is the killer app for big data. I said that backwards. The killer app for big data, big data is the killer app for functional programming. I think nothing shows its value better than like that Spark example I just showed you. Even more so than things like concerns for writing good concurrency code. So we want, you know, we need to get people to think more functionally and less object-orientedly. All right, so that's the JVM in general, though. It's actually a really good platform overall, despite its flaws. Why is Scala so good? Well, I think it's in part because it's a pragmatic mixture of object-oriented and functional programming. And of course, there are plenty of purists who say that it shouldn't be object-oriented at all. But actually, it does a lot of important things. Spark would not be nearly as big as it is if it was written in Scala Z, for example. And that's not a criticism of Scala Z. It's just the sort of mental gap required to go from, I'm an enterprise Java developer, I was thrown in this big data team, you know, help. Well, you can actually make that transition more easily with Scala. So it's a good mix of supporting the idea of using abstractions and separate implementations. You know, the abstractions aren't always purely functional in practical or, you know, real world libraries, Spark especially, but we have the facilities for doing that, as we've seen. And I'm going to come back to this a few times, but it's really important in big data that we can optimize as much as we have to get the performance we need. So often that means that we need well-encapsulated mutation, you know, like slamming byte arrays or whatever to get work done. So I'm going to claim that this part of the success is due to the Scala big data sandwich, which, you know, if you're looking at it, you know, like scopes coming down, you know, it starts with objects as modules, and this is something that Martin Odersky had in mind with Scala, was that we needed a good module system, and objects are fine for encapsulation. And you could do that without inheritance, right? So it's not necessarily an inheritance thing. What we really want are functional APIs that are what the end user works with, but we need to encapsulate implementations that can be, you know, highly optimized, even mutable as needed. And that sort of separation between the API abstractions and the internal implementation is really important. Another reason Scala is really good, I mentioned this actually a little bit already, is we have a REPL that we can work with interactively, and these new notebooks that are sort of a graphical view on the REPL. This is my favorite right now, which is the Spark notebook, and I just sort of grabbed it. Actually, all the code on here is actually pure Scala, but you know, it wouldn't all fit. But it's part of a Spark program, and it has built-in graphing for stuff like this. So that's really handy for, you know, a richer experience. The Spark API is based on the Scala Collections API, which, you know, for all its flaws that are mostly implementation flaws, I would argue, it's really fairly easy to understand how to use the Scala API, and in part because it doesn't give you a lot of, or require a lot of ceremony, it just gets the job done. In fact, I think the Spark API does a slightly better job of sort of the vision of clean separation between the abstractions and then what goes on under the hood. When you're writing that code at the top, you're actually building up a data flow graph that will be lazily evaluated and optimized and distributed and all that stuff. So I think actually this is about as good as you could get for a big data functional API. And I would say that it's actually better that it doesn't have a lot of the sort of functional ceremony that we've heard a lot about here, even though it would be more technically correct if it had monads everywhere or applicatives or whatever. This gets the work done. I can walk into a room full of Java and Python developers, and by the end of the day, they can walk away with enough Scala and enough Spark to write this themselves. You know, if this were based on, you know, Scala Z streams or whatever, maybe that's a better model, you know, in terms of perfection, but it would be a lot harder to make that transition. So I think this, in terms of pragmatism, this really, you know, is a home run in my opinion. Because we can sequence together all these beautiful operations with relatively little, you know, heavy lifting on our part. So I'll claim that the Scala does just fine without the reader monad. There was a Twitter, and I'm not criticizing the reader monad, okay? But there was a Twitter argument or a discussion recently that I successfully avoided jumping into, where people were saying, oh my God, it's loading stuff without the reader monad. And I felt like jumping in and saying, get a life. You know, it's not the most important problem to worry about. What keeps me up at night actually is the technical debt inside Spark itself. That's what I worry about. I don't worry about mutability leaking through the API so much. Okay, well, let me just mention a few other things on the subject of Scala. And this is actually a general comment about Scala versus Java now that we have lambdas in Java. Why do we still want Scala? Why would I feel sad if I had to use the Java 8 API for Spark? So you can take this home with you when you're trying to convince your boss to let you use Scala. And if you think back to the example I just wrote, I use tuples everywhere because they're so concise for just expressing, you know, structure in a very concise way with minimal ceremony. And remember I mentioned that line where I just moved parentheses and how fun that was to write. Pattern matching, it would be hard to live without this for, you know, quickly tearing down a structure and then rebuilding it another way. The type inference is really wonderful for knowing what you just did, especially when you're learning the API. I recently worked with the Python API for Spark, and it's amazing how close they are. You could easily mechanically translate the Python API to the Scala API or your code written in them. But what I really missed more than anything was that I would do something in the Python API and I wasn't quite sure what I got. So I had to, like, you know, do printf on a few lines to see what I had, whereas the REPL in Scala would say you just created an RDD of this tuple type, where the tuple type is the record type that you just are using. So I really love the inference, plus the safety it gives us, right? And of course, Scala is really great for building DSLs, and that data frame is a good example of something that's actually very close to a Python API that they were able to munge into Scala using the DSL features. Actually, there was one more, and that is just having a REPL and the notebooks to interactively explore as well as learn. All right, let's go back to Spark and deep dive on some performance issues and what they're doing to make the performance even better. So I mentioned this data frame API that's sort of the programmatic version of a SQL query language, and that's effectively what it is. And it's for any data where you already know the schema and you want to work with relational-like operators like group by and select and that sort of thing. The name comes from actually similar models in Python and R libraries. So here's sort of a grep of the key methods that the DataFrame API gives you. And if I showed you the equivalent for that original RDD API, you would see that there's a lot less stuff here. So we're actually, it goes back to this kind of theme through this conference, that the idea that if you constrain what you can do, you actually give yourself freedom to do other things. You know, maybe to be more correct, to do more optimizations. And in this case, it's an optimization benefit. By limiting ourselves to what would be essentially a SQL query planning problem, they're able to do a lot of very clever engineering inside to support just these features, which are like, again, like the 80-20 kind of need for most people that are just asking questions of data. They just want to do SQL in some sense of the word. So in fact, when they rolled this data API out, they announced something that was a dramatic step of evolution, if you will, in big data. This was a performance graph, and what they're showing is that if you're using the old RDD API, it's about twice as slow in Python versus Scala. But if you use the data frame API, they're actually equal in performance. It used to be in big data, you would have your data modelers, you know, the data scientist guys use Python or something to create their model, and then they would heave it over a partition wall to a bunch of Java developers who would incorrectly implement it in Java. And of course, it's not very agile, right? But now, if, you know, aside from concerns about deploying anything in production, you can get the same performance just by deploying the Python code. And the way they're getting this is they're actually generating JVM bytecode under the hood. So again, you're writing to this very thin layer API, and then you're generating the kind of code you want underneath. But even this isn't good enough because of those performance issues I mentioned when we were talking about Java. And so there's this initiative called Project Tungsten where they're trying to improve the performance even beyond what I just showed you. So I have mixed feelings about this. It is focused on the data frame side, and it makes sense because I said that that's a more constrained problem, but I actually don't like that API very much. Being a Scala guy, I prefer the RDD API in general. But yeah, anyway, you do what you gotta do. So some academic research and the experience of the biggest developer of Spark, which is Databricks, it was founded by the creators of Spark, found that most Spark jobs are CPU bound. This is actually very different than MapReduce, where the general rule was they're always I/O bound, you know, whether it was disk or network I/O. So they found that, you know, just improving network I/O, maybe you can get 2% faster. Disk I/O, maybe 20%. So if you want to get orders of magnitude improvement, you're going to have to look elsewhere. And the reason this is true is a lot has changed in the last 10 years. We have much faster hardware, networks and solid-state drives. Spark is much smarter about getting rid of data it doesn't need, so it eliminates that overhead. We talked a little bit about caching as a way of getting better performance, and there's a lot we could say about why that's a real problem in MapReduce, which we won't. Data formats like Parquet give you much more optimal I/O performance. And then there's actually more serialization, compression, and hashing going on because of the way all this is implemented. So it actually does tip the balance toward the CPU. So what we really want to do is improve the way we perform once we're in process. So this is a three-pronged initiative. One is to actually avoid the Java object model overhead and actually have custom data structures for storing things in an efficient way and using custom memory management, either on-heap or off-heap, but basically doing it themselves. And then try to thereby eliminate as much garbage that has to be collected as possible. So if I have, you know, a big chunk of garbage, but it's one chunk, that's easier to manage than if that's broken up into a billion little chunks that I have to manage. And also the algorithms that would be better for cache awareness, so you'd get more cache hits. So recall that we looked at all this, you know, indirection and stuff for Java. We'd like to eliminate as much of that as possible. We talked about how the heaps tend to be very big, and that causes problems with collecting all that data later on. And the one I alluded to a minute ago that's another initiative is when we're evaluating statements like this, these kinds of expressions, we'd like to eliminate the sort of naive thing that would happen if you just convert this to Spark or rather a Scala code, which is inevitably you end up doing like virtual function calls. If those are like integers, I'd probably have to box them in Java integers. And that's overhead, and branching statements can be expensive. So we want to instead, or they want to, they being the Spark project, want to do custom bytecode generation that avoids all this overhead. Because again, all these things add up when you're doing billions of them versus what you might do in a typical payroll calculation app that doesn't need this kind of performance. Okay, so we're going to do custom memory management and cacheware algorithms and data structures and then code gen. So here's the first thing they're doing. They're using our old friend Sun, Miss, Unsafe to do explicit memory management. And they invented this new representation for rows called compact rows. So this would be like, you know, a single row of my data set. It starts off with a bit field, which will have a bit set to 1 if there's a null value for that particular field. Otherwise, it'll be 0. If it's not null, then it'll show up in the next section, which will be an 8-byte field lined up with the schema, you know, the actual values for that particular field. If it's a primitive that would fit in 8 bytes, it's just inlined. But if it's a variable length thing like a string, then that'll actually be a reference to the end of the vector or a byte array is what it really is, that will be, you know, some variable length set of data. So it, you know, if you think about cache lines, you could fit some of these in a single cache line, others maybe across several, but it'd be very fast to go through the bytes and extract the data. And this is what they're doing for a better hash map. They're calling it a bytes-to-bytes map, where it'll be like a memory page in their model, and then just key-value pairs lined up one after the other for each of these hash buckets. And both of these together, and this, there's a whole lot more going on here, and once again, there's a link in the slide speaker notes if you want to see details. You know, they'll improve garbage collection and cache misses. All right, so to get close to the end then, the last thing they're going to do in this Tungsten project is generating bytecode for those expressions to eliminate all of this overhead that I discussed a minute ago. And the results so far have been really impressive. The latest release had like version 2 of this project, and you know they keep lopping off like 50% of the performance with each step. Last thing I want to talk about is go back to streaming a little bit. We've had a little discussion at this conference about reactive streams. And then we've got this streaming model called DStreams that TypeSafe has actually contributed code to. Well, I have concerns about the robustness of this thing. It's actually fairly complex to manage these chunks of data, to run a Spark job, to make sure it finishes before the next data chunk is ready and so forth. And then there's the classic problem of, with any streaming system, which is what happens if you know, you're running this thing for years, which is possible, and suddenly the consumers cannot keep up with the producers. You know, it's some major news event or whatever, and I've got data streaming in faster than I can process it. That's why back pressure was introduced with reactive streams. The idea that there's this dynamic flow control mechanism that where the consumer and the producer negotiate the rate of data flowing through. So, and you have a bounded queue, so you never run out of memory with those. TypeSafe actually contributed not the reactive stream standard per se, but a dynamic back pressure mechanism in the latest release of Spark, and we're hoping to actually make a stream reactive streams compliant consumer in a future version of Spark. All right, let me conclude with some final remarks then, and then I'll take questions. There's no question Spark is driving Scala adoption. All of the anecdotal evidence and some survey data we've seen indicates this is the case. So it's generally good for our community in general. But Spark could be a lot more pure. So all this kind of stuff that we've talked about with, you know, well, category theory, among other things, I think it should be used more internal to Spark, but I really like the fact that the API is low ceremony. I think it should be that way for making it widely applicable and embraceable by people. Not to say that something like reactive streams or FS squared is wrong. It's definitely not what I'm saying, but that's always going to be a special tool for experts, not a general tool for relative amateurs, in my opinion. And there's way too much technical debt in the Spark code base. This, I think, is the biggest risk to Spark's long-term survival as a viable big data tool. On the other side, Scala could, I think, especially in the collections API, do a little bit better separating the interface abstractions from the boilerplate of the implementation. You really shouldn't see can build from in the API signatures, in my opinion. I'm not saying I know exactly what we should do here. There have been some good talks this week about rethinking collections, but this is something I hope to see. And Martin Odersky himself, let's see, there it goes, has actually said, you know what, there's actually some nice methods they've done to extend this API that we should bring back into the collections API. He's done this talk already, and there's one coming up at the Spark Summit in a few weeks here in the EU. And so, for example, there's a bunch of, this is maybe a little small to read, but a bunch of things that we don't really have conveniently in the Scala API, like group by and things that are more key aware, as opposed to I've got this general blob of data, I don't know what it is, but if I know that it's keys and values, I could do some optimization. So we might see some movement to get some of these things moved back into the Scala APIs. And I'm also wondering too if we shouldn't also adopt some of those Tungsten optimizations. Some of those special types that they're implementing could be really useful in general. So the last thing I'll say then is that TypeSafe, and this is really my responsibility, I guess, really embrace Spark as the future of big data. And I also think Mesos may eventually replace Hadoop as sort of the underpinnings of it. So that's kind of our long-term direction. So please pay us money to help make this happen. And that's all I have. Thank you.